is Adonis awesome?
My God is awesome. He can move a mountain, keep me in the valley, hide before the rain.
Come on, Adonis awesome.
My God is awesome. Heals me when I'm broken.
Strength
where I've been weak.
People downgrade and betray, you should be a different shade. Being black in America shouldn't be the price we pay. Everybody wanna say change, but they ain't trying to change. Living in this modern day could tear you down, make you lose your faith. Get no respect, knees in our necks, fighting for justice. So many discussions about justice, but we see nothing. Crazy how we gotta riot and protest for them to see we saying something. A brown egg is the same as a white egg, just a different color. Discrimination at its finest. It's crazy how our brothers and sisters gotta keep dying. The people who's supposed to stop the violence is promoting violence. I gotta worry about going outside, hoping that no one try me. It's a cold, scary world with a cruel system. Why they gotta keep shooting while we keep resisting? Why they gotta keep harassing because of our image? It's like the whole world surrounded by the word privilege. I'll never get it. But I love my skin, I love my culture. I love my people, support my people, fist up for the lost ones. It's crazy how someone's complexion can have someone so bothered. But being black is beautiful, just know you're so awesome. God is always on your side throughout the harsh times, throughout the muddy roads, speed bumps, and long rides. Just remember who you are, and your skin is fine. I know the rain keeps coming, but we finna shine, and we gonna be all right.
I had a long day, I just wanna relax. Don't have time for my friends, no time to chit chat. Problems at my job, wondering what to do. I know I should be working, but I'm thinking of you. And just when I think this crazy world is gonna bring me down, that's when your smile comes around. Oh, I love the way you hold me. My massage will always be. You take each and every day, make it special in some way. I love the way you hold me. In your arms will always be. You take each and every day, make it special in some way. I love you more than the words in my brain can express. I can't imagine even loving you less. Lord, I love the way you hold me. Oh, 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 oh. No, I love the way you hold me. Oh, 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 oh. Boy, you took my day and you flipped it around. Calmed the tidal wave and put my feet on the ground. Forever in my heart, always on my mind. It's crazy how I think about you all of the time. And just when I think I'm about to figure you out, you make me want to sing and shout. I love the way you hold me. My massage will always be. You take each and every day, make it special in some way. I love the way you hold me. In your arms will always be. You take each and every day, make it special in some way. I love you more than the words of my brain can express. I can't imagine even loving you less. Lord, I love the way you hold me. Oh, 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 oh.
I could tell you in a short story or poem, but all I have is my voice and this guitar, and you have my heart. Oh, I love the way you hold me. My massage will always be. You take each and every day, make it special in some way. I love the way you hold me. In your arms will always be. You take each and every day, every day. I love the way you hold me. My massage will always be. You make each and every day, oh, so special. I love the way you hold me. In your arms will always be. You take each and every day, make it special in some way. I love you more than the words in my brain can express. guess I can't imagine even loving you less. Lord, I love the way you hold me. No, I love the way you hold me. Oh, 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 oh,
oh, oh, oh, oh, until you gave your life to find me, and no hope until you reached the place confining me. And now I've learned all the sacrifice you made. Your passion touched my heart, and now I say, yeah, I can say, your love is better than life. Yes, it is. Yes, it is. It's better than life. Better than life. Yes, yes. Oh. Better than life, your love for me. It's better than life. Better than life. Yeah. Yeah, 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 yeah. Oh, 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 yeah. Oh, 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 oh.
This is Reverend Thomas Brett Keene, again back for the second night of virtual revival for your theme, Get Back to Christ. So just a little recap from the other night. We came from the subject of Why Me, God? And we talked a little bit about Moses, and we talked about, you know, the question, what the real question is, of not asking why me, God, or why me for this call to Christ, but why not us. We talked about the the barriers and the obstacles and the oppressions that we have to overcome in order to get to a place where we're putting ourselves in a position to really focus on the purpose that God has called us to focus on. Tonight, we're going to go into another text in another direction. So we're going to actually come from the subject, or actually, I'm sorry, the text, Mark chapter 10, verses 17 through 27. We're going to read this text from the New Living Translation. And the Word of God reads, "As Jesus was starting on his way to Jerusalem, a man came running up to him, knelt down and asked, 'Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?' 'Why do you call me good?' Jesus asked. 'Only God is truly good. But to answer your question, you know the commandments. You must not murder. You must not commit adultery. You must not steal. You must not testify falsely. You must not cheat anyone. Honor your father and your mother.' 'Teacher,' the man replied, 'I've obeyed all these commandments since I was young.' Looking at the man, Jesus felt genuine love for him. 'There is still one thing you haven't done,' he told him. 'Go and sell all your possessions and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me.' At this, the man's face fell, and he went away sad, for he had many possessions. Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, 'How hard is it for the rich to enter the kingdom of God?' This amazed them, but Jesus said again, 'Dear children, it is very hard to enter the kingdom of God. In fact, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter the kingdom of God.' The disciples were astounded. 'Then who in the world can be saved?' they asked. Jesus looked at them intently and said, 'Humanly speaking, it is impossible, but not with God. Everything is possible with God.'" Let us pray. Lord, we ask that you would speak tonight. Lord, we ask that you would open up the word and that you would give us fresh revelation so that we may take this and find pieces where we can apply to our lives. That we can apply to our lives so that we can be a blessing to others, that we can find ourselves following you and to become more like you. Lord, I ask that you allow me to decrease and you increase. Allow the words out of my mouth be the words that come directly from you. Lord, we ask for a prophetic anointing right now. Lord, we thank you, we praise you in Jesus' name, amen. All right, so I want to talk to you from the subject, barriers. Barriers. So Ebenezer, I have to admit that for years I have looked at this particular passage of scripture, that I've looked at this particular text from one lens. We often look at this scripture, we often look at this story, we often look at this text from a place of condemnation unto the rich young ruler for walking away from Jesus because he wasn't willing to sell his possessions. We start to ask ourselves the question, how dare he? How dare this rich dude that got all of this stuff, he probably got all of this money, he probably got all of this cattle, he probably has all of this land, how dare he walk away from Jesus? You know how churchy and spiritual we get. How dare he walk away from Jesus and he got all of this stuff? How could he possibly? He has everything that he could possibly have. He was probably born into this wealth. He would probably inherited this stuff. And he probably has more than enough for himself that he could share with other people. But family, I had to be challenged as I looked at this story, and I had to really stop to ask myself, but what if we are really the rich young ruler? What if I am the rich young ruler? I started to think about a story when I was young. I think it was probably around the fourth or fifth grade. My family wasn't rich, but They did decent for themselves, and they made often Christmas and birthdays feel like that we had more than enough. My parents had a good way of just being blue collar, middle class workers that, you know, when we wanted things, we didn't often get it right away. But when they were able to make the means to get those things, whether it was toys or clothes or anything of that nature, like, they would make sure that we were taken care of on our birthdays and Christmas, if anything else. I can remember times where I'm just under the Christmas tree before Christmas comes, and I'm counting my gifts because I can't wait to open up the many things that I could possibly get. Things that I knew that I wanted, that I asked for. You know, times that I asked for a Nintendo, times that I asked for a Super Nintendo, times that I asked for a PlayStation, things of that nature. I knew there were times that it were things under the tree that I know that I was going to get. And there was times, there were things that I was shocked about, that there were things that I really loved and enjoyed, that my parents really knew who I was as a child, and they made a provision for me to have these things. But as a child, and most children act, you know, once we are watching the television, or we're going into the toy stores, or we're going into, at the time it was Toys R Us, where a kid could be a kid. And, you know, we would see things on the TV, or we would see things at the Toys R Us, or we would see things at the Kmart, and we'd be like, Mom, I want that. Dad, I want that. And I can remember there were some things that I wanted, but there was already toys that I already had in the house. There were things that I wanted that I asked for that I was like, because I didn't even know why I wanted it. I didn't know why I thought I needed it, but because I saw it, I wanted it. And I proceeded to ask my dad one day. We were in the store, and I said, Dad, I want that. I want this, and I want that. I was saying all types of things that I wanted in a toy store, right? And so my dad proceeded to say, he said, before I can buy you some new things, you're going to have to get rid of some of your old toys, because you got all of these old toys and all these old things in the house. But in order for me to buy these things, when I'm able to buy them, you got to get rid of some of your old stuff. So I was feeling some type of way, right? I was feeling some type of way because I did not want to give up the old toys that I had. I wanted the old toys along with the new things that I wanted. Now, realistically, I knew I probably didn't have space, and that I was probably falling over the toys that were already in my room, in the closet and on the floor and other places that I tried to stash it. But I was thinking, I don't want to give up my old things. I want the old things along with the new things. But my dad was trying to tell me that if you want these new things, you're going to have to give these old toys away. And we can find an organization where there's young people that may not have the toys that they want or that they have. And you're going to have to give some things away in order to get the new things. Now, I started to get upset. I started to get mad because I couldn't possibly fathom to think about giving my old toys away. And it's not that I didn't think that the kids that he was talking about didn't need them. I just didn't want to give up what I had. I wanted what I wanted. I wanted the old games and I wanted the new games. I wanted the old toys and I wanted the new toys. I wanted the old clothes and I wanted the new clothes. I wanted it all. And it makes me think how often, even if we're not in a position of wealth, and even not in a position of privilege, how often do we find ourselves in the place of the rich young ruler? In verse 17, we find that the text says that Jesus is on a journey, which likely suggests that he was with his disciples on their way to Jerusalem. As we engage, we find there is a theme of discipleship that's being suggested in this story, as it also appears in Mark chapter 9, verse 33, and also in chapter 10, verses 13 through 16, as he begins to speak in parables about the requirements of entering into the kingdom of heaven. And those requirements were described to be like those who come to him like children. This reminds me of when many of us first accepted our call to our relationship with Christ, whether we were young in age or whether we were young in the faith. It reminds us of the eagerness of us being on fire for God and having that zeal. We wanted to be at church every day and serving on every committee and at every rehearsal, and finding ourselves saying that, you know, we can't go to parties anymore, or saying that we could only hang out with a certain group of friends. You know how we was when we first accepted our relationship to Christ. We got all seditious and stuff, and, you know, we had to change everything. You know, we started to throw stuff out and started to, you know, just make ourselves look in a different appearance because we were so excited of the way that we come to Christ. And often that zeal, that energy, that excitement was explained or elaborated on in the previous scriptures as just kind of the requirements of finding our place, of getting into that place of the kingdom of heaven. But the scripture goes on to say that a man, referring to the rich young ruler, went to kneel down before Jesus. It is assumed that Jesus had been traveling with his disciples, and that out of reverence to who Jesus was, the rich young man ran up to catch up with him and kneeled. And some interpretations suggesting that him kneeling suggests that he was actually bowing down to Jesus out of reverence, because he just wanted the opportunity to share a few moments with Jesus so that he would be able to get an important question that was burning in his heart. He then asks the question, "Good teacher, what should I be doing so that I will gain eternal life?" See, it's interesting that these verses start off this way after the previous story suggested that the way to engage the kingdom of God was to come as if you are a little child. This suggests again that that the thought at the time there were things that you needed to do to obtain eternal life. But eternal life can be interpreted differently, as many think that eternal life may refer to the afterlife after you die. But many studies suggest that the young man was more so requiring, what is it that I need to do to obtain eternal happiness? Jesus then responds that you should be following these commandments. You should be following the commandments of, you know, you should not murder, you should not commit adultery, you should not steal, you should not falsely testify, you should be making sure that you honor your mother and your father. You need to start and to engage in doing these things if you want to be able to get to that place of eternal life. And when Jesus responds that way, and it's almost like in a response, like the rich young ruler, he was like, really? Like, Jesus, my dude, Jesus. Like, I've been doing that since I was a young Mo out on the streets, on Mothers, right? I've been doing that, Mo. Like Slim, like, that's easy. I've been doing all that. I've been going to church every Sunday. I've been a part of the choir. I've been going to every rehearsal. I've been serving on the usher board. I go to Sunday school every week. I do good things for people all the time. But verse 21, it was interesting in this response. In verse 21, Jesus in his response, and we see the humanity of Jesus being showed here. In the New Living Translation version, it says that Jesus had genuine love for him, which begs the question of condemnation that we often put on the rich young ruler when we look at this text from a very skewed perspective. And it talks about the genuine love that Jesus had for him. So we see that he wasn't necessarily looking at the rich young ruler because he had this wealth or these possessions. He wasn't making any condemnations of the things that he had, but more so he was letting him know that's good. That's fine, young man. But in order to get to that place of eternal happiness that you desire, to get to that place of the kingdom of God, I need you to go and sell all of your possessions and give the money to the poor, and then you will have treasures in heaven. Then come, follow me. That brings me to my 2 points, which are more so like 2 questions this evening, and I'm going to get out your way. Number one, what are we willing to give up for the justice of others? What are we willing to give up for the justice of others in our community, justice of others that are living around us? Now, it may be easy to look at this rich man with a side eye, but because the text seems to imply that he has many possessions, that he has a lot of wealth. But back to my question in the beginning, are we often in the place of this rich man? How often do we overlook those who are in need of justice from a social, economic, environmental, and not to even mention food justice perspective? How often do we walk past people daily because we have preconceived judgments and views of the situations that they may be in based on the way that they look, smell, or talk? How often do we make it our efforts to give out of our own pockets, and we're not trying to hold on to what we have? You know how we get, you know, when we pass somebody on the street and they ask us for a dollar, or they ask us to help them buy them food, and we know we got cash in our pocket, we know that we got money in our pocket, and we like, nah, I ain't got nothing. Understand that often we can find ourselves in a place or in the mindset that some of us may be operating like the rich young ruler. There's a group of us that we want to hold on to what we got, because and we know that for many of us, there's a group of us, not all of us, but there's a group of us that when we want something, we can pretty much get what we want. We can get the toys, we can get the tablets, we can get the new iPhones, we can get the new video games, the new systems. But what if we were challenged by God to give those things away so that others may have? Jesus gives 3 verbs or actions to go, sell, and give. What if this is not a matter of this being the actual process of getting into the kingdom of heaven? But what if this is not a matter of the actual process or the formula of getting back to Christ or getting to heaven, but what if this more so is a question of the heart that we have to actually follow him? Jesus' affection and love for him was not saying that he wasn't good enough to have treasure in heaven. And Jesus never condemned the rich young ruler for saying that he was a horrible person. But young people, Ebenezer, folks, let me get you to understand that I think Jesus was trying to get him to understand that our attendance at church is not enough. Knowing the commandments are not enough. Doing good things are not enough. But what are we willing to give of ourselves in order to follow Christ? What are we willing to give so that others may have? He then says, come and follow me. So after I make a decision, this not only do we need to consider the question of what is it that we're willing to give up, because after we make this decision, then we have to go and follow him. And the idea of following him is means that I am trusting in the direction that I'm being led in after I give up these things. So do I really trust the direction that Christ is sending me after I'm willing to make this sacrifice for him? Do I really trust him the way that I say that I do? Do I really trust that I can give up some of these things and that he knows and sees what's best for me as I go down this path? I can imagine what the rich young ruler may be asking. If I give my things away, will I ever have anything again? Will I be able to survive? Will I feel less important? Will I be looked down upon like others look down upon the poor? What type of life will I have now if I start to trust and follow in this way? But for those who trust him, trust in God to rule their lives and should have no trouble ridding themselves of possessions. Matthew 6:19-21 already tells us, don't store up treasures on earth, and wherever your treasure is, there are the desires of your heart will also be. When we put our trust in the things that we have and not willing to let go, you know, that was me. That was me as a child, as a fourth or fifth grade. I didn't want to let go of my toys. I didn't want to let go of my clothes. I didn't want to let go to give to somebody else because I wanted it all to myself. And I have to admit that I was selfish. And many of us have to look and ask ourselves, are we operating in selfishness? But understand, to follow Jesus is discipleship. Discipleship is a relationship established by the call of Christ and is defined by his faithfulness. Discipleship is not by any merit that can be attributed to any one person, not the disciples and not this young ruler. Verse 22 says that this scripture says that the rich young ruler walks away saddened. The original Greek defines saddened at that he walks away with a gloomy appearance. Now let's be careful. To be fair, the text never said that he ultimately decided to hold on to his possessions. It never said that he wasn't willing to give up these things to follow Christ, but that he was saddened, meaning that in his original approach to God, when he asked his original question to God, he did not get the response that he was looking for. He was eager because he felt like that he had done enough, but realized that he needed to do more that required sacrifice on his part. You know how we get. Mom, can I get that new iPhone? Dad, can I get that new PlayStation 5? You know, can I get the new J's? I cleaned my room. I did my homework. I took the trash out. I even cleaned up that funky bathroom. What else I gotta do? He walked away saddened. He walked away in disbelief like, man, I thought I was doing something. I know the commandments. Like, I've been doing good things, but understand, it takes more. Because there's Jesus is wanting us to give. Verse 23 says, Jesus then turns to his disciples, and over the next couple of verses, talks about how difficult it is for the rich to enter the kingdom of God. He gives the analogy of it being easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich person to enter into the kingdom of God. I don't believe that this labels all rich people, but I believe that this text is giving us a warning of putting wealth before God, and that this could be a dangerous thing, and it's potentially a warning to us that may cause us to lose who we really are. What are we willing to sacrifice to follow him? What are we willing to give? Ultimately, if I can be honest, even as a 40-year-old man, I struggle with the idea of sacrifice. I am that rich young ruler often, because every new stage that I enter into in my life, throughout this path, it requires me to give up a piece of myself so that others can live. I don't always get it right, but I am reminded in the times that I do, because there was an ultimate sacrifice that happened so that I could live. And that sacrifice came in the form of Jesus. If he could give it all so that I could live, I could certainly fight through the discomfort of giving the little that I have that doesn't even belong to me anyway. Young people, Ebenezer, what are you willing to give? Young people, are you willing to give for the justice of others? Are you willing to be a voice for the voiceless? Are you willing to trust that he will provide to you what you need and what you desire, even when it causes you to give up something in your life? Often I find myself learning that no matter what I've tried to obtain, whether it's, you know, I'm trying to make more money, whether I'm trying to, do more in ministry, that whatever I try to do in this life, it requires me to give up something. There's a cost to it. There's no easy way to get anything. And at the end of the day, if I'm doing these things just for my own personal gain and personal satisfaction, I'm not really getting anywhere. But the true measure of me seeking that eternal happiness is me giving up as much as I can. And I have to constantly challenge myself to do those things, to give up things, to give up my time, to give up my talent, to give up my money, whatever it takes, so that others can have an opportunity. Because equity is more important to me than the things that I can acquire for myself. I have a pretty decent car. I have a pretty decent house. I have a pretty decent life, but life is not about that. Am I willing to forsake these things so that others can have? I'm challenged with those thoughts. I'm challenged with those questions. We've talked about the last couple of nights about getting back to Christ. And I think I mentioned in the first message, I mentioned that I don't think it's always, that question was problematic, because what does that really look like? But I think part of it is making sure that, number one, when we talked about that why me God, God is putting us in a position to really give ourselves. And then when we think about the barriers that we have to overcome, and I didn't really talk about those barriers, but that barrier of the looking past the things that we have and the things that we have to give up, that may become a barrier for what it is that we need to do, that we may give to others. I encourage you this evening, get in a place where you are strengthening your walk, that you're willing to give, and that you are in a place where you're not worried so much about yourself, not congratulating yourself for the great things that you've done, but putting yourself in a place where Christ would be pleased. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for this time. We thank you for your young people. We thank you for this space. Lord, we pray that something was said or done that would give glory to your name. Lord, we thank you. We praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. Again, I want to open up, in a sense, the doors of the church virtually. We did the same thing the other night, on Monday night. I want to offer Christ to you. I want to offer this opportunity to not necessarily thinking about that afterlife or where we're going to go when we leave this earth, but we can have that type of eternal life here, right here on earth, as we find joy in our Savior for the things that we can do for those, our brothers and sisters, while we're here on earth. I just don't want to do things just to find myself going to this place, to heaven, or I don't want that focus to be on heaven. I don't want to be that focus of I'm doing things just to get to a certain aspect. But I want to be filled with the love of Christ in such a way that I'm so confident in my relationship with God, and so confident that I can move past these struggles of giving and sacrificing and questioning the purpose of God in my life. And I just want to do as much for people that God desires me to do while I'm here on earth. I want to invite this opportunity for you to make a decision. Again, Ebenezer, those who may be watching, you can type in the comments, you can message the church through their Facebook page, you can get in contact with Pastor Jackson. Whatever it is you need to do, we invite Christ to you on this evening. Make a decision. Don't allow tomorrow to come without making a decision today. God bless you, love you all, and thank you for this opportunity to share.
Hallelujah. Amen. And thank you, Jesus, for all that you have done for us. That was a powerful word. Now listen, I cannot explain to you how excited I am for the things that God has in store. I'm just so amazed at what he's doing in the kingdom and with his kingdom people. So make sure you tune in tomorrow for more exciting praise and worship, and glory be unto him who is able to do all things. We love you, but God loves you best.